These ancient sort of, you know, watches. Not using the iPhone.
All right, any questions from y'all before we get going?
Everything is perfectly clear.
All right. Well, today should look very familiar to most of you. It will hopefully be beneficial for folks that are sitting in and working in last quarter as well. So we're going to review GLNs again. The idea here is to, A, a couple of objectives, make sure that we are all on the same page. Number one, going into the next phase of this. Two is that I think this could be a very good kind of first study guide for you guys as you're thinking about the methods exam in 211, kind of the main points that came out in 211. And then three is to really highlight this concept of model and specification as we go into the next phase of where we are. So, that's our goal. So, Ben, with 100% light, can you see that? Yeah, you good?
It's pretty rough, but it's okay.
What's that?
I don't know.
Anyone turning it 75%?
Oh, I have dissenting opinions here. Oh, yeah, we're going to have to find it out.
You can just turn off the front bank, right?
What's that? That's the 75.
Yeah.
It's better.
It's way better.
Okay, all right. Olivia, whoa. We're overruled right now. I'm sorry.
I'll survive.
Okay. You're right underneath the light. Okay. All right. So as we think about defining a GLM, remember, if you're asked to ever define a GLM, a GLM is defined by three components, okay? So as you go through, so we have the first component, which is the random component, and the definition of a GLM, a generalized linear model, means that the probability distribution for the response is a member of the exponential family, okay? So in our cases, we've kind of focused primarily on, say, binary outcomes where we've got a Bernoulli binomial response counts, say, where we might start off thinking we have Poisson distributed counts or continuous outcomes where we might think about linear regression. Other members of this, of course, would be the gamma. Okay, so the gamma would fall naturally into the same study. Then we have the systematic component. And again, systematic component, in my terminology, what I usually will specify that as is the quote-unquote mean model. It's the linear predictor inside of that GLM. Okay? So it's a function of the way that we have been treating these known and conditioned upon covariates. Those are my x's and unknown regression parameters, betas. Those are the things that I'm scientifically interested in estimating and drawing inference upon. Okay. So again, taking it back to the normal linear regression case, same as the systematic component there. The difference that we had going into beyond kind of moving outside of the normal distribution for the probability model, but the other difference from, say, 210 in the linear regression days was that now we want to take that linear predictor, that mean model, and link it to the mean function through some transformation. And so what I'm going to call G here, or the link function. And give me some reasons why we would choose G. What are the guiding principles in choosing a link? So one is the interpretation of those betas, right? So the scientific question. So what is the contrast that I want to form across subpopulations, right? Excellent. So if I take a log link, that puts me on a multiplicative mean model scale, right? So I'm thinking about additive differences in subpopulations relating to relative differences in means. Okay. Good. What else? In the support of the range, right, of that linear predictor, right? So this thing is taking on values. These are unrestricted in our language. They're minus infinity to infinity. So that linear predictor can range from minus infinity to infinity. So generally, for model fit, you usually want to take G such that we have common support. In other words, the G of mu also takes on values of minus infinity to infinity. Okay. All right, good. Those are the two main reasons. And the classic examples you guys now all know and love, right? So what I've got there is the classic linear regression model, normally distributed response, member of the exponential family, systematic component is just your linear predictor, link function identity. We worked a lot with the logistic model, and we also worked a lot with the Poisson model. And in the case of the logistic, We had what we called the canonical beam. That's just the logos. Canonical beam is what, again, it's coming up in a minute, but terminology-wise, what do you mean when I mean canonical beam? So it's theta, so it's the term that is multiplied by y, the response in the exponential family form for the PDF, right? And we call that theta the canonical parameter. That thing is a function of mu, the mean. And so therefore we take that function of the mean and call it the canonical leak. Okay, so it is the naturally occurring transformation of the mean that matches up with the response in the exponential family. Okay? So canonical meaning natural, right? So similarly for the Poisson distribution, canonical link is the log. And so this is what we were just now referring to. So that canonical parameter here is theta. I'm going to define it again on the next slide coming up, but you have it there. And then what I have typically done is to get you guys to think outside of the usual exponential family. We talk about quote-unquote exponential dispersion families. And what that means is I've got that A of 5 that's sitting down there on the bottom. And again, if that A of 5 is equal to 1, that just means we have a distribution, our distribution, I should say, is a member of just the regular exponential family. Sans the dispersion portion of this. Okay. Good. So the reason that GLMs work out so nicely, well, part of the reason is because there are really nice identities in terms of the mean and the variance and how those things are tied together. Again, if you step back and you think about kind of the theory that we developed, it all fell into place really nicely because you have this unique dependence between the mean and the variance functions as you go through. Okay. And so if we think about the score function, that's just, again, first derivative of the likelihood with respect to the unknown parameter vector. Here my theta would be my under my unknown betas. We're inside of that regression model. What you guys showed for me last quarter was what you said, look, maximum likelihood under a regular family, I know that the expectation of the score function is equal to 0. That means it's what kind of an estimating function it gives rise to. So if I set u of theta equal to 0 and I solve for theta, right? So in other words, I'm solving for my maximum likelihood estimate here. That becomes now an estimating equation. And the fact that this thing has expectation equal to 0 means it's what kind of an estimating equation or terminology? Its expectation is this thing that I'm setting it equal to. Become very important for us as we go. If you go back to your 211 notes, I did define that for you guys. I said it's a special type of estimating equation. And it's an unbiased estimating equation. It's actually in lecture 1 and lecture 5. So the score function then is, it has expectation 0. Again, you guys showed this to me. The way that you were able to show that to me was by being able to interchange differentiation and integration. Remember and think about how you do that. So remember how to do these things. So part of this is the review. Thinking about how we can get back to these things. Then the variance of the score is actually equal to the expectation of the score squared. That's coming from the fact that the score has mean 0. And we also show that that's equal to minus the expectation of the derivative of the score. So in other words, the second derivative of the log likelihood with respect to theta. This thing has a name. What is the name of that? Fisher information, right, under likelihood theory. Okay. Good. But using those two facts, then we were able to show that for an exponential family, if y has a PDF that's a member of an exponential family, that the mean of y is equal to b prime of theta, where again b is coming from my representation sitting here inside of the exponential family. And the variance of y is equal to that over dispersion parameter times b double prime of theta. Okay.
again, the key thing here is this is the link that you're talking, no pun intended on the link, not talking about GPU, but this is the connection that makes this stuff work out, because you have the mean being tied to the variance, it's just the second derivative of that E of theta function. So, a couple of definitions again. We talked about the canonical link already. When I talk about the variance function, I'm talking about V of usually some function of mu. Special case there would be the normal case where V of mu is just equal to 1. Okay, so it doesn't actually depend upon the mean when you've got homostochastic variance in the classic linear regression case. But the overall variance of Y then is going to be that dispersion times what I'm referring to as the variance function. And I separate these things out because usually we have that dispersion function is going to be some phi, which is going to be constant across observations, divided by, we can rewrite it in terms of weight, it's divided by what I'm going to call weight, the little wi here. Okay, and what we're going to see later is that little wi, and some of you guys showed this to me actually, for the binomial distribution, really comes down to sample size generally. So if you think about binomial data, this will be the sample size within inside of each binomial sample. This will be little n I in the notation that I used before. Classic word. So again, wi some known weight, phi being some scale parameter. Thinking back to your days of the OLS model, so classic normal linear regression model, what would phi be in that case? You guys denoted it as squared, right? So that was your dispersion parameter in the normal case. And V of mu in that case was 1. Go back. Okay. So again, some scale constant parameter under homoscedasticity that's just sigma squared. The weights become 1 because you just have an observation, a single observation per unit. And then V of mu does not depend upon the mean in the classic normal linear regression model. So far, so good. It's all feeling comfortable. I don't know where we're at. Okay. So if we think about a couple of families, again, just to kind of bring this concept of the weighting home, if I think about the binomial family, so I'm going to assume that S is the sum of binary responses. Okay, so S follows a binomial distribution, independent binary responses. So S follows a binomial distribution having sample size, say, m, that's number of trials, and then probability of success, mu. I'm going to switch over in this class to this notation for my response, just to make things easier as we go. So I'm going to take y as my response to be the sample proportion. Right? So it's the total number of successes divided by total number of trials. Slightly different notation than I used last quarter. Okay, so you can note that. Okay. And if I look at now at the PDF of y, I can rewrite it into a form that says, okay, now I've got my response as the sample proportion. The weight that goes with that response is 1 over n, denoting what the underlying denominator was for that particular sample proportion. Okay, because y itself does not follow a binomial distribution, correct? Y, in fact, would be approximately normally distributed in large classes. Okay. All right. So, again, does this now start to ring bells in terms of how you would fit a binomial regression model inside of R? Does it start to make sense why they parameterized it that way? How do you fit a binomial regression model inside of R? You can fit sample proportion, and then you can put in an argument that it's the weights, and the weights then are just simply the number of observations that you had in each particular cell, if you will. Okay. So the sample size. So that's exactly the translation for R going from the exponential family into the GLM quote unquote function. Okay. So again, if that's shaky for you guys, well, we're gonna do a binomial example again soon, so you'll see that at play again in R. But you can also go back to the 211 notes where we did that. Good. Just to double check a few things, if I take v prime of theta now, I had better get back the mean mu, and I certainly do. That's just the exponent function. Okay, so v is the linear predictor over 1 plus. And then finally, if I take a of phi times v double prime of theta, I had better get back to something that looks like my good old
Bernoulli variance divided by M in this case, because I've standardized now for the sample proportion here. So I just get back to mu times 1 minus mu, all divided by my sample size, which I do. Okay? So far, so good. Good. So we'll kind of fly through now the Poisson, similar concept. Again, theta is the canonical length, so that's going to be the log of mu. Key thing here is that a of phi is equal to 1 in the Poisson distribution. And then e of theta equaling the exponentiated theta is just going to give me back that the mean and variance are both equal to one another. So mu for the mean, mu for the variance. Good. So let's look quickly at an example, and then we're going to kind of fly through some of the inferential procedures that we had developed last time in the context of the Probe-by example. So part of my motivation here is, one, I've only given you really one example of analyzing Poisson data in class. So I'm going to give you another example on this. And then we're going to, or Poisson-like data, I should say. And then we're going to explore sample fit here, again, similar to what we had done in lecture 12 of last quarter. So, again, this particular trial had 59 subjects. We talked about this yesterday. Subjects were repeatedly measured over time. The idea was to look and see whether Probivide, which is a treatment for minimizing the rate, or lowering, I should say, the rate of seizures among these epileptic patients. And so we wanted to assess whether that was actually effective relative to placebo. And so these folks were measured every 2 weeks for up to 8 weeks going outside of the trial, but we're just going to focus on the last visit. Okay? So I'm going to take two models because we haven't dealt with correlated data yet. I'm just going to focus on a single response, a univariate response here for a moment. So we'll think about Y4, that's the total count of seizures that are occurring at the fourth visit, so in other words, the last 2 weeks of the 8 week follow-up. And we're going to fit a model that says we're going to consider two models. One is a linear regression model, one is a Poisson regression model. So for the linear model, on both of them, I should say, the linear predictor is going to look like age, adjustment for the baseline number of seizures, and then an indicator of treatment. This is a randomized study. Just thinking for a second about the two models that I have. Do I need to adjust for age? Let's think about model one, the linear regression model. So again, my goal here is to be able to estimate the effect of treatment, right? I mean, that's the goal of the study, on the mean number of seizures over a 2 week. Okay, good, Arseny. So do I have to adjust for age, though, to estimate treatment and do that correctly?
No.
No, right. So because I don't have confounding, because I've got randomization, right? So from that context, it should be fine. It's a randomized study. But Arseny is absolutely right. If age is predictive of seizures, which it tends to be in epileptic patients, the older you get, the more seizures you tend to have. Well, it's kind of quadratic in some sense, but we're talking about older adults. Then individuals of higher age are likely to have higher numbers of seizures, and so I'm adjusting for it for what benefits are seen.
Lower variance.
Good. So that's a precision variable, right? To try and increase the precision on my estimate of the treatment effect by reducing variation in count of seizures. Okay? That's with me. Baseline number of seizures. Same context, right? People that tend to have a high number of seizures before you do anything to them are going to tend to be high with their number of seizures after as well, usually. So it's going to be predictive. Okay. So in other words, those with more severe disease, you can think about it as, are likely to have higher numbers of seizures later on. So thinking of baseline also as a precision variable. Okay. And then finally, treatment, which is the predictor of interest in this case. Does that make sense why I'm formulating the model in that way? Everybody? Okay, good. So, now, let's go ahead and fit a couple of these models. I'm going to actually jump over to R just to remind us what we've got. And
post up my code on the course web page for y'all as well. So the seizure data is up, it's called seizure.csv for you guys. This is just a recreation of the box plot that I had fit before. And I'm gonna go ahead and fit that, just that simple linear regression model that we had from last time, where what I'm doing here is I'm just taking subsetting to time 4, so the last measurement that's there, and then regressing that number of seizures at time 4 on an age baseline and then my indicator of treatment. So, somebody go ahead and give me an interpretation of the estimate of treatment here. Probably. I'll give you a hint. We estimate that.
Expected associated decrease for patients on probiotic is one less seizure.
Okay, good. So I'm going to rephrase just slightly. Okay. So we estimate that patients randomized to probiotic experienced approximately 1.36 fewer numbers of seizures over the final 2-week period of the trial compared to individuals randomized to placebo who were of similar age and had a similar number of baseline seizures. Right? That with me on this? Good. Sebastian?
Actually, I just wanted to go back to the question of age and baseline seizures being decision variables.
Yep.
So if we know that our experimental design is meant to compensate for, or we can assume that it takes care of any of that confounding, shouldn't we keep age and baseline out for parsimony?
So parsimony for what reason, Sebastian? So why do we like parsimony out of the
time? Well, I guess usually it's to prevent collinearity in variants of patients.
So do we have, are we gonna worry about collinearity here necessarily? With treatment? Yeah, unlikely, right? Because we got randomized, right? So it's gonna be orthogonal. So there's that. Also parsimony though, because we don't want to waste information on estimating useless parameters, so to speak, right? So in other words, we can use degrees of freedom in that context, okay? But the reason that we are doing it is because if we believe that they are strong predictors of the response, then it actually works the opposite way. You actually gain information, right? And remember back in the 211 days, we showed you in the linear regression setting, you consistently estimate the same effect, but the variance goes down if you're predictive of the response. So that's a reason why people would tend to do it. Now, it does bring up an interesting point in that actually, in the real world, so when you're working with regulatory agencies, they would be unlikely to allow you to adjust for age in this context. It's very customary to adjust for baseline severity of disease because you're really kind of looking at the change among people that we're gonna talk about. But the reason why, Sebastian, that actually that happens in the real world context with like regulatory agencies and things like that is because they don't want people playing around with different models. So saying, well, maybe if I just throw this in and I've got kind of conditional confounding. So, you know, I was unlucky in the randomization because randomization isn't perfect, right? If you go to 59 people, I might have imbalances that are there. And so if you start playing around with other variables, you start getting into a multiple testing problem. And so regulatory agencies tend to say, no, you have to pre-specify, you can adjust for baseline because we know that's going to be highly predictive, but not the response necessarily. So it does come up actually. Good. Okay, so that's one of our particular models. So that's the linear regression model. So this goes back to, I think it was Arnie that said, I said, why do we choose a particular link? And Arnie's first response, which I agree with, is scientific interpretation. So here I'm looking at the absolute effect. Right? So in other words, the absolute difference in the number of seizures occurring over that final 2-week period. If I wanted to look at a relative effect, the link function that I would go with in the GLM setting, log, right? So then I can look at the relative effect on them. So in other words, what's the relative reduction, probiotic versus placebo here. So the other potential problem though that we're gonna have with the linear regression model is what? We're dealing with count data, right? So if you're dealing with count data, you might think that, in fact,
the mean is in some way tied to the variance, similar to a Poisson distribution, yeah? And if the mean is tied to the variance, then guess what's going to happen? Well, we know that the baseline number of seizures is affecting the mean. So as that baseline number of seizures changes from one patient to the next, what's happening to the variance of the response? It's changing from one patient to the next, right? So you have heteroscedasticity. So you would expect to see that. And so if you went back to your days of 210 and you said, okay, well, let's suppose for a second that I wanted to investigate heteroscedasticity here, you would probably form a plot that is just the residuals from that linear regression model, and you'd fit it against the fitted values. Again, the reason that you did that is because normally when you have heteroscedasticity, the changes in the variance are going to be tied to changes in the mean. It's going to be tied to a function of the mean, particularly, obviously, in exponential families like we've been discussing. But if you look at this plot, this is about as classic of the bullhorn shape that you would ever see, right? I mean, as your kind of mean is growing, your variation is growing across those different counts, okay? So that's telling you already that if I go back to my results here, pop quiz for you guys, on that summary output that's sitting right there, what do I trust and what do I not trust?
The estimates you trust, the variances you don't, and complex probabilities.
So I think I heard this. Do I trust this guy? Yeah, that's going to be unbiased either way, right? Heteroscedasticity or not. That's a bias and it's consistent. Problems come in, though. Do I trust this and this? No, because that's a function of the variance. And we know that the variance for these estimators are going to be incorrect because we assume that they are homoscedastic errors of the responses, but our plot just now clearly dictated there was heteroscedasticity there, and you can see it. So, wouldn't trust these, right, or saying you wouldn't trust these, you wouldn't trust the p-value, it's not the end. So the inference that you've done at the end of the day is going to be likely be incorrect in this case. Good, okay, so we might then think about incorporating the mean variance relationship there, and you could do that in the identity link case. I'm gonna go ahead and do it in the Poisson regression case. We'll start off with an assumption of that the accounts are distributed Poisson. So I'm gonna fit the second model that I have inside of you guys' notes. There we go. And so here, let me jump back up. So now I'm gonna fit the analogous GLN using a Poisson distribution, accounting for the mean variance relationship, and now thinking about things on a relative scale. One thing that you will notice here is that when I fit this guy, I am not accounting for an offset. Why not?
Yeah, the same exposure times.
It's the same exposure time, right? In this particular study, because it was by design, I know that my time number four there is the total count of seizures over 2 weeks. Everybody was followed for 2 weeks. So my offset would have been log 2 for everyone. So it really wouldn't matter. So it's always constant. Okay. Good. So the only reason you need to care about an offset is when you have differential exposure, which you usually do, to be quite honest. You usually have differential exposure times, either over space or time you're going to observe. This particular case, because we've got a design study, I know it's over 2 weeks for every person. So again, if I fit this guy, now the Poisson regression model, now somebody give me an interpretation of the effective treatment. Start it off, we estimate that.
Oh, we estimate that the relative odds of...
Let me stop you there. Not for the linear regression, it's Poisson regression. It's a mean. The mean is a count or a rate, right, over 2 weeks, truly. So, okay, so now go ahead back again. So, relative rate.
Yeah, the relative rate of the groups under treatment and without treatment is 0.76.
Okay, comparing treated to untreated patients, who are similar with respect to age and number of seizures at baseline, right? So I'm might rephrase it just slightly, but we estimate that there is approximately a 24% reduction in the rate of seizures over a two-week period, over the final two-week period of the trial, comparing treated patients to placebo patients, similar with respect to baseline age and number of seizures. Okay, good. So a similar story, in other words, a reduction that's going on there. What do we know, what do we notice about the inference here? Relative to the linear model.
Well, we have significant, like without
yeah.
the power.
There's quite a bit higher precision in that estimate that's sitting there, right? I mean, as we go through. So, could be one of two things. What's one reason we why we might have just greater precision in terms of our estimate that's sitting here? Well, it could be three things. One is you could tell me, well, it's just a different parameter than the rest of it, which it is, a different function, right? Difference versus ratio, that's one thing. What's number two, though, in terms of the way that we fit this particular model versus the way that we fit the linear regression model?
Well, maybe the model fits better, so we basically have lower estimate of the variance.
Yeah, but our predictor of interest is binary, so it's really not a functional form type of thing, right? It's really estimating two means. Now, there is adjustment for baseline seizures and age, but that's unlikely to be the major cause for a binary. What's a big difference between the OLS model that I fit at the top and the Poisson model in terms of the estimation of the parameters? Am I weighting by anything in my estimating equation for the OLS model? No. Every observation has the same weight. Am I weighting by anything in the Poisson regression model? What am I weighting by? What comes up in the estimated equation? Good. What I'm weighting by that part? I hope so. That's the OLS estimating equation, right? With no weights on anything else. What am I weighting by in the Poisson model? I'm weighting by the inverse of the variance. Is that going to gain me efficiency if I have changing variances? Yes, it will, right? It will gain you efficiency. It's Gauss-Markov again. I mean, it's coming at you from a slightly different point of view, but it's saying upweight observations with low variance and downweight observations with high variance for a more efficient estimator at the end of the day. Okay. The change in the link is obviously coming in too because we had a link function there. But again, one aspect of the differential inference could be driven by the fact that you're now weighting observations in your estimating equation by the inverse of the variance. Okay. Good. Now, there is a third possibility though, which is what? Over dispersion, right? It may not be that it's Poisson distributed. So everything that I've based the z value on and these confidence interval limits on still could be wrong because I may not have the correct variance function that's sitting there as well. So that's the third possibility, right? Maybe I shouldn't even trust it. All right, good. So what we want to do is think about this inference, what it depends upon, and then investigate it in this particular case. You guys all with me, Jackson?
Yeah. I have maybe a naive question, but yeah, I wonder why don't we have anything like an offset in the case of just simple logistic regression, like with binary outcome? So nothing like exposure time kind of thing.
So in the logistic regression case, there's nothing that you would hold constant on the linear predictor. So that's, again, what an offset is, right? It's something that you have in the linear predictor where you're not going to estimate a parameter that's associated with it. And so when you think about that log odds, there's something you would hold constant. Now, what you do is, for binomial data, again, you want to put in a weight. And so that's that you can almost, it, that's not the correct terminology, by the way. Offset has a very particular definition in statistics. It's a parameter, my linear predictor, that I'm not going to ask you for. So, or I'm sorry, a variable in my linear predictor that I'm not estimating the coefficient for. But in the case of binomial data, you can put in a weight, and you can almost think about that as like, you know, something that's adjusting for sample size, which is an analogous thing that you're doing in the offset for a Poisson distribution. So, okay. So now, let's go back and just review quickly the inferential results that we have for the GLM for that latter Poisson case, and then we'll go back and investigate whether we can trust that inference. Okay. So again, I'm starting off with an exponential family. You guys have gotten very good at this, particularly on the midterm. First, write down the log likelihood. That works out nicely in the exponential family because now you just get something that's linear in the y's. You're summing across for the log likelihood. Everybody remembers this and loves it, right? So if you got to take the derivative of that log likelihood to solve the maximum likelihood equations, then you're going to have to take DL, d theta, d theta, d mu, d mu, d theta, d theta, d beta. It's fun to say it. You just got to do it over and over again. But the chain rule is definitely your friend. And what you can use, and again, where the beauty, I would say, of the GLM framework comes in is, again, that tie between the mean and the variance, because you're using that to piece apart, if you will, the elements of that chain rule and to tie them all back into the mean, okay? And after you've done that and tied them all back into the mean, you can nicely see that the estimating equation, the score equation down here, as I've set it to zero, has a nice form for you that looks similar to what we had before. And in particular, if I assume an identity link, then I'm talking about weighted least squares. That's weighted least squares where I'm weighting by the inverse of the variance that's sitting there, right, from back in your 210 days. And now if I'm talking about a GLM in general for an exponential family where I allow a link function between the mean and the linear predictor, that dA to d mu inverse is just accounting for the transformation of the mean. And so now I have something that's still familiar to me, though, which looks like y minus its mean times covariates, weighted by the inverse of the variance, accounting for the nonlinear transformation of the mean to the linear predictor. So, and you can see easily here that the score function, not that you didn't know it already, but it's very easy to see here, is an unbiased estimating equation. Right? So I take the expectation of that thing, I get E of y minus mu, and that thing goes to zero. Okay. Good. So we are going to learn to, if you haven't already, love this particular form of an estimating equation very, very soon. We're going to rely upon it throughout the rest of the quarter. And if I write this thing in terms of matrix notation, it's going to look like the way I'm going to write it through class is d transpose e inverse y minus mu. So now I can, d is just my matrix with my elements for my change of variables from the link function, d mu d beta. And then b is going to be my diagonal matrix in this case with the variance of y down the diagonals. So it can be inverse there, weighted by the inverse of the variance. Good. Notice that the x for the design matrix is getting sunk up in here because this is not d mu d eta, this is d mu d beta. Okay, so you can think about the change rule coming in there. Okay. Good. So what we learned last time though was that if we wanted to solve for the MLEs, we had to do that through some numeric computation because there is no closed form, so we use Newton-Raphson. This was the Newton-Raphson algorithm in that case. We actually drew a bigger connection by saying, hey, let's think about Fisher scoring. So in other words, let's replace this derivative of the score function inverse with just Fisher information inverse. So in other words, the expectation of that guy. All right. And by doing that and linking it back to the exponential family, we said, oh, well, if I want to know what the Fisher information looks like for an exponential family model, I can just simply take the expectation of the score for the jth observation and the score for the j prime observation, or covariate in this case, take the expectation of that product, and what you'll see is you get an expectation of y minus mu squared as you pull these things together. Well, that's just v of mu. So one of those v of mu's cancels, and you get a very nice form for Fisher information that's sitting down here. We use that nice form and said, oh, well, in this case then, I can write the Fisher information as just x transpose times w times x, where w just now has my link transformation derivative divided by my variance of the response. And in that case, we were able then to map back the Fisher scoring algorithm and say, oh, well, the updates then for the Fisher scoring algorithm ultimately have a form that looks like x transpose wx inverse x transpose wz. And you guys all saw that and said, oh, that's great, because this looks like weighted least squares. This is what we've done in the past. It looks like my good old WLS estimator. The only difference now is there's a little k that's floating on each of these guys. And that little k is coming from the fact that we have to iterate that process, because we don't know what the weight is each time it changes, each time we change our estimate of beta. Z that's sitting down here is just a transformation of the linear predictor. We call this Z what? Just to make sure that we're all on the same page. The working response, right? And you can think about it as the first order Taylor expansion of g of y about mu. So that z is called the working response at the kth iteration in this particular case, where I've gotten it denoted by k. But again, the key thing that I want you guys thinking about is you're doing nothing more than weighted least squares. You're using the variance back to your benefit in weighting by the inverse of the variance. And then you're dealing with the transformation on the link through the deviated mu. Okay, good. So these become your weight functions. If you guys want, I didn't have you guys do it, but for fun, you can write your own interrelated weighted least squares. It would be very easy for any GLM now. Just like nothing, okay? Just pop in those same weights and run back. Okay. The other beautiful thing that we had from this is, well, okay, now that we've got these interrelated weighted least squares, we step back and we say, if I specify the probability distribution correctly, then I get all of the asymptotic results for inference on those parameter estimates from the NLEs. Okay? And so we thought about testing some subset of parameters in the regression model. Oftentimes we might want to test a single scalar parameter equal to a particular value, for example, the coefficient that's associated with treatment in the Progovide setting. Or we might test multiple parameters simultaneously. So for example, if we're testing an entire construct or a interaction term. So in that case then, if I just decompose my parameter vector into the things that I want to test versus the things that I'm controlling for inside of that model, and similarly partition up the information matrix, I can formulate some nice results just through quadratic asymptotic theory. Forms and asymptotic theory. And in particular, what we would do is we would say, well, under the null hypothesis, I'm going to constrain the parameters I'm looking to test under HO, whatever those values are. And I've got to go through and I've got to solve for what the MLE is on my remaining components. So I'll call that beta 2 hat. Beta 2 not, I should say. Then the results that we had from last time is that saying, okay, well, U transpose, that's the score, that's going to be approximately normally distributed. This is its variance inverse sitting here, the Fisher information inverse times U, so that's a quadratic form. That guy will in fact walk to a chi-square with R degrees of freedom, R being the number of parameters in beta 1, 0. Let me get that right. This guy. Length of that. Okay. Good. Then we also had the Wald test, which we could form in an analogous way. Some of you guys fought with finding I11.2, but I think we got it at the end of the day. That guy is also distributed chi squared R. And then finally, at your disposal, a likelihood ratio test. Simply taking the log likelihood under the restricted null model, comparing that to the log likelihood under the unrestricted model, and then multiplying by a -2, that guy is approximately chi squared. How do you get to basically the first two results versus the last result? So if you wanted to prove these, for example, for the score statistic, what would you be doing there? Approximately normal, if we did that through. Not necessarily on the score, actually. It wasn't part of the regularity conditions either. It stems from that. Score becomes a little easier because that's just the CLT. And then the IID, right? It's just a sum of random variables. That's what the score is, right? It's a sum of independent random variables. So we just normalized it, right, and then appealed to the central limit theorem. Now, in the regression context, the score, the elements of the score are not all going to be IID. The one I did for you was IID. In the regression context, it won't be IID. They'll have different variances. So what central limit theorem would you have to appeal to if you wanted to prove that? Lindbergh-Feller, right? So I'd have to deal with the variances changing between each one of these cases. So good. So Arne, you're absolutely right. So start off with this thing, normality. We showed already quite easily that this was the variance of it, so that was pretty easy. That was just interchange and integration differentiation. And then putting everything together then is just a quadratic form, right? So normal, multivariate normal, I should say, times the inverse of its variance covariance times multivariate normal. Okay. Good. Same thing was true for the wall. What about the likelihood ratio statistic? That one goes slightly differently. Again, kind of trying to review the Taylor. That one's the Taylor expansion. That's the second order, right, Arseny, on the Taylor expansion. Good. Good, good, good. So again, things to keep back in your mind as you're going through and studying for the method exams. Both this class and 200 if you're taking that. Okay, so now I didn't spend a ton of time on measures of discrepancy. I did spend some, but I want to kind of rehash and draw some connections for you guys on measures of discrepancy. And the first one I want to think about is the deviance again. So again, when we think about deviance, it's inherently tied to the log likelihood. Okay. And so if I write down the log likelihood for an exponential family model where theta hat I now is the MLE of theta under my presumed model, then I can rewrite that log likelihood really by just noting, it's nothing fancy going on here, just noting that theta is a function of my unknown means, okay? If you think about writing down that exponential family, everything is kind of implicit that's sitting in here. So you write things in terms of theta, but theta is a function of the means are functions of betas, right, that we've solved at the end of the day, hence all that chain rule argument that we've been doing. So now, what is the deviance? Well, I defined this for you guys last time. The deviance is 2 times the difference in the log likelihoods for the saturated model and the current model that you are entertaining. And what I mean by saturated model is it is the model that fits the observed data perfectly. So you notice here I've got a yi as opposed to the estimated mean of yi. Right, so it's my observed data because I can predict that yi perfectly with the saturated model. Similarly up here for the theta of yi. Okay, so this would be a more formal definition, if you will, if you wanted to implement the deviance in practice than what I gave you. I gave it to you in words in 211. That's what it comes down to be in terms of the log likelihoods. Okay. Good. So if you think about the deviance, it's kind of interesting to do this. You start to notice a few things for measures of discrepancy. If you think about the normal model, remember, that's an exponential family model where now phi is just sigma squared. We talked about that last time. V of mu is just simply equal to 1. So if you write down the deviance in terms of what I just had on the previous slide, you get something that's very near and dear and familiar to you all, just the sum of the squared errors. Right? And you've thought about that all along as a measure of goodness of fit,
back in your 210 days. How well am I fitting my observed data with my estimated means as I'm walking through? If you think about the Poisson distribution, oops, I've forgotten something here. What goes on down here? I need a half there. Give me a half, a mu I half. But if you think about the deviance now as a measure of goodness of fit in this case, it should start to look intuitive, right? I'm accounting for how far I am away from my true, my observed y here, as well as how far I am away from my observed y here, okay? And the fact that I've got two of these is coming because I have a nonlinear link function, a log link that's coming up in there. Good. And then finally, we have the deviance residual. And I defined this for you guys last time. The deviance residual is simply the sign of whether you're over or underestimating times the square root of DI, where DI is the contribution to the model deviance. So then the deviance we can compute actually just by simply summing up the squared deviance residuals at the end of the day. So that'll give you back the deviance statistics that I showed you previously on the previous slide. So the other residual that really speaks to discrepancy, and really this is thinking about, again, discrepancy relative to the variance assumption, truly, is the Pearson statistic. We defined this last time. I'm going to rewrite it just slightly this quarter because I'm going to deal with these little weights a lot. So again, I'm keeping my phi and holding it out, assuming phi looks like a scalar divided by some weight, if you will. Okay, so it might be sample size in the binomial setting. Then the analogous definition for the Pearson residual just looks like observed value minus fitted mean divided by the square root of the assumed model variance under the best estimates mu I hat. Okay, that's what the Pearson statistic residual is. The Pearson statistic says simply square those Pearson residuals and then sum them up across observations. And the reason that we're doing this is, first of all, this guy should have mean zero, because that's how we're estimating the mu I hats. And it should have a variance that is constant as long as we've specified V of mu I correctly. And the constant should be whatever phi is, whatever we've assumed phi to be inside of that model, ultimately is that constant. Okay. So like in the Poisson case, like we've been talking about, that should be one. I think that's what Jalen had told me last time we were in class. And the expectation of that squared Pearson. So now, if we look at the Pearson statistics for multiple models, you can see some nice things. Again, if you go back to the normal case, the Pearson statistic agrees exactly with the deviance statistic. It's just the sums of squared errors. If you think about the binomial model, the Pearson statistic just simply looks like observed minus expected squared divided by the variance of my responses. A very natural kind of statistic that you would be thinking about standardizing each of those squared errors by the variance. And then finally, if you look at the Poisson model, you look at something like observed minus expected squared divided by expected. Does that look familiar to anybody?
Yes.
It's the statistic.
I like yes. Thank you.
And what's the statistic for
or what now?
Test.
Yes, this is exactly the statistic for a chi-square test in contingency tables. And the reason why is because a chi-square test is looking at counts in cells. And what you're saying is I've got an observed count in cells minus expected count in cells. And if I assume those cells are distributed Poisson, their variance is just equal to their mean. So that's where that's coming from. Good. Was that your yes, Francis?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, that's what I was hoping for. So now, if we were thinking about this in a contingency table setting, you know, what would you tell me the approximate distribution of that would have been? Right, you said this is what comes up when we think about the Pearson statistic for a contingency table. What would its distribution be? What would you compare that to?
X-squared.
Sum of observed minus expected divided by
X-squared.
Chi-squared, right? What degrees of freedom?
of testing the difference between
the number of cells minus two.
Good, so I lose a degree of freedom on the cells, on the rows, and on the columns, right? So I get number of rows minus one times number of columns minus one. It's because I give up one degree of freedom on the columns and one degree of freedom on the rows because I have to estimate the overall mean on each of those, right? So if you're thinking about it that way, then would you conjecture that these things have an approximate distribution in this case? It's a similar concept. I'm just taking in each of my cells an observed minus expected squared divided by expected. So the analogy here is that this thing would be distributed off approximately chi-squared. The degrees of freedom in that case would be my total sample size. That's what you had in your previous contingency table setting. But I would lose some degrees of freedom for estimating what? The mean. So I would subtract off the number of parameters in the mean model. So I might expect this thing to be approximately chi-squared n minus p, where p is the number of parameters in my mean model. So it's an exact connection actually between contingency squared analyses and the GLM context that I have here. Okay. And so, in fact, that is exactly what is true. Both the Pearson squared statistic and the deviance statistic. In the case of a normal regression setting, where the responses are truly normal and we have homostaticity, the sums of squared errors, you guys know, are in fact distributed chi squared n minus p times sigma squared. You guys actually saw that back in 10. You will prove that in 200C if you haven't proved it already. I'm gonna write that exactly. That's simply because when I take these sums of squares, these are my residuals, they are normal. I divide through by sigma squared, I get a normal 0, 1, they're all independent, I start summing them up. Right? I just lose p degrees of freedom because they're tied together in some way because I've estimated common mean across them. Okay? So those p parameters. Well, in other cases, it's not, we can't write down exactly, so I don't have a dot up there for the distributed as for that tilde. In other cases, inside of the exponential family, these guys are approximately chi-squared with n minus p degrees of freedom. And we can just simply show that by taking what we know about the likelihood ratio statistic and its asymptotic distribution as well as the Wallace statistic, getting back at that. They're just sum of the squared. They're basically quadratic forms. The one case where this does not hold, you guys have seen, what is that one case where I can't get a handle on the asymptotic distribution of the deviance statistic?
Maybe when it's sort of redundant, like when we have it.
It's not quite redundancy. You guys have seen it. Where did I say that the deviance statistic breaks down? Can't use it as goodness of business. Can't compare it to a chi-square. Binary random variables, right? So if it's a binary response, this does not hold. The reason it does not hold, give it to me in one sentence.
Deviance is always zero.
The deviance is always zero, right? It's not random, it's degenerate. Just sitting there at zero. Okay. So always degenerate in the binary case. So you can't get a handle on the asymptotic distribution, the difference between the log like the deviance and your current. Good. So, the fact though that we have this in other settings, so outside of the binary setting, so binomial data, Poisson data, gamma distributed responses, normal distributed responses, is nice because we get this nice relationship that says, well, either the deviance statistic or the Pearson squared statistic should be going off the distribution to a scale chi-square distribution where the scale parameter is just 5. And the assumed model, having n minus p degrees of freedom. And the nice thing is then, is if I know that fact, then that gives me a nice moment-based estimator of what phi would be. And we actually used this and looked at it last time. We used this one right over here for the GEL data, the melanoma data back in 2011. So I computed the Pearson statistic, and we saw that it was approximately 1.47. And we said, oh, that means we're off by a factor of 1.47. On average, for our assumption. So this relationship means that we could use either one of these statistics to try and estimate the quote-unquote over-dispersion parameter that's inside of the model. Again, take this back for just one second to the normal linear regression case with homoscedasticity and make sure that that makes sense to you. In that case, what is x squared? Sums of squared errors, right? So I've got SSE divided by n minus p. You guys called that the MSE, right? You were estimating sigma squared in that case. That's phi in the normal, classic normal linear regression case, right? With functions of SSE. Same thing is true over here on the deviant side. So both of those things give you MSE, the natural estimator that you had, and in fact, the bias-adjusted MLE inside of the normal regression. Now, you can estimate either way here. Most software packages, if you go to estimate phi, the dispersion parameter, they will give you back the Pearson statistics, sorry, divided by minus p, not the deviance. There's really not a rule that says one works better in terms of consistency or bias for estimating phi, but it's just become customary that most software packages, including R, will give you back the Pearson statistic divided by n minus p as your estimate of what phi would be. Okay. I think Stata is the only exception. It just gives you back both of them at the same time. Okay. So now, again, what we just talked about was for the normal case, for that Pearson statistic divided by n minus p, oh, you just get back, oops, let's see here, a sigma squared over phi. Oh, yeah, okay, I have an approximate. I thought I had an equal there. I was going to make you guys put hats on these things, but it should be approximate. That's good. For the binomial case, what you should get back is approximately 1. That's because in the truly binomial case, you're taking phi to be 1 by assumption. Similarly, that's true for the Poisson case. You're taking phi to be 1. So, again, if the model holds and you truly have a binomial mean variance relationship, that Pearson statistic divided by a minus p should come out to be approximately. Both of those cases. True for the Poisson case as well. So now let's go back in to the probabide setting because we talked about the potential differences in inference that we're seeing here. And let's examine whether we've correctly specified that the response is a Poisson distribution. So in order to do that, we'll do it two ways. I'll show you the Pearson statistic as well as the deviance residual statistic as well. So I'm going to pull both of those guys off. The way you would do that is feed in the probabide fit, pull off the Pearson residual or the deviance residual in the next one. The degrees of freedom in this case are 59 minus 4, right? I've got 4 parameters in my mean model. So I've got an intercept, I've got baseline number of speakers, age, and the treatments. That's where the 4 is coming. And then finally, if I sum those guys up, that's going to be my D or my X squared in my notation. So my Pearson estimate of phi is about 2.48. And then my deviance-based estimate of phi is about 2.67. Again, they will not agree in small samples. They will agree asymptotically, but they will both be consistent for phi. Okay. That overall marginal. So when I look at this, though, and we talked about this at the end of the class yesterday, how do I interpret that 2.48 now that I've done this? If you wanted to explain that number to somebody, say, okay, I came up and I got this Pearson statistic estimate of phi, and it's 2.48, what does that mean?
Well, if we underestimate the variance, 2.48
variance in general. Great. So you can think about it, so that's exactly right. So you might explain it by saying the true variance for the responses that we observe in our data are approximately 2.5 times bigger than what we assume with a Poisson regression model. Okay? And that thing, and this is you're assuming that it's a scale off, that it's always 2.5 times bigger. In other words, you have the true Poisson variance and you're multiplying it by 2.5. Which may or may not necessarily be true when we're looking at examples of where that comes into play. But the implication of that then is that because you've got the scalar that's out there, that means that all of the variances for each of your coefficients actually feed through by that scalar. So the reported variances that I have up here, actually let me just do a summary of yield and fit. When I look at these standard errors, each one of those are off by a scale factor of the square root of 2.5, roughly. Right? Because their true variance should be 2.5 bigger than what I'm assuming under the Poisson model. You guys with me on that? And that is the impact of doing such a thing. Okay? It's like assuming that you have a data set, if you will, that's 2.5 times larger than what you have. Okay? You have that much more precision than you actually have. It's a way to another. The true variance is 2.5 times larger than what we're assuming.
Yes, but when you said there's another way to put this, you said that the actual data set is 2.5 times larger than it is. Why didn't you say
that? So the analogy here is that your estimates, and you can use the analogy to say that your estimates assume that your data set is 2.5 times larger. Have times more observations, right? Because if you think about the variance, it's sigma squared divided by n, right? And my n is off by 2.5 fold, or my sigma squared is off by 2.5 fold, so you can translate that into the sample size as well, right? You know, so that's the other way to think about it if you're trying to convince somebody of the importance of this. Because I don't really have 150 patients, I have approximately 60. That's what, that's one of the fixes that we're going to have, and that's going to be called a quasi-Poisson model. Actually, there's a name for doing that. But I wouldn't multiply the standard errors by 2.5. I would multiply the standard errors by the square root of 2.5. And so that's actually where we're going next. Is that one of the fixes that we're going to have, Marcella. So again, that's going to be called a quasi-Poisson fit. Good. So with that, let's talk about how to implement these graphs. Take over this first section. You guys can take that around. Concept of exactly what Monticello was just now asking about is, well, what are we going to do then to fix up the inference on that particular study? We know we can't trust what's actually written there. So how do we deal with it? I first want to kind of motivate, though, a little bit more in terms of how overdispersion arises. And let me just define it for you guys since I haven't actually written it down on the slide. But overdispersion, the definition is that it sort of describes the situation when the variance of your response, this is the true variance of your response, is greater than the GLM variance, in other words, the assumed GLM variance. So if you're asked to define overdispersion, that is what the definition of overdispersion is. Okay? So an example might be that if we had binomial data, or if you assume, that you have binomial data, so in other words, you have sums of binary random variables, you might start by assuming that the mean of the y's is mu, in which case, that under the binomial assumption, the variance of the y's would be mu times 1 minus mu divided by m, the sample size in each binomial cluster trial. If you have overdispersion, it simply means that the true variance of the y's is greater than that assumption under the binomial distribution. Okay? And similarly, in the Poisson case, the existence of overdispersion would say that the true variance of your response, say your count, would be greater than the mean of that count. So that would be overdispersed relative to the Poisson distribution. Okay. So let's first think about how overdispersion arises, and then we'll think about its impact, and then finally how we correct for it at the end of the day. So a classic case where overdispersion arises is that if you've got quote-unquote grouped binomial data, and you guys will see an example of this towards the end of this lecture. Not today, but the end of this lecture. So let's take the case where I've got binary responses, say yij. I sum those guys up, and I divide by mi, the number of trials, if you will, in the ith cluster that's sitting there. So now, each of these individual yij's is binary, so it's a Bernoulli, but they may not necessarily be independent in all cases, right? And that's really kind of a major motivation for our class. So it's like if I sampled all of you guys inside of a classroom and gave you guys each an indicator of 1 versus 0 for pass, no pass, for example. Well, if I do that now and I sample multiple classrooms across UCI, I'm likely to have correlation in those binary responses within inside of the classroom. If nothing else, you guys on here are tied to the same Oracle teacher, and other people aren't. It's a joke. I get nothing for answering. Thank you. I appreciate that. I want to point out that somebody on one of my reviews said I was kind of funny, and I'm going to take that. Kind of funny. I'm debating getting a frame for it, but
they didn't have it assigned at the end either, right?
No, yeah, that's it. So, you know, I wanted to say something nice, so like, well, kind of, I suppose. Maybe on Tuesdays. So, again, if you're thinking about the Bernoulli case, if you had truly independent Bernoulli observations, in other words, no correlation floating around, then you would know that, in fact, S would be distributed binomial in this particular case. But as soon as correlation floats around, that's not going to be the situation. Another classic case is in Poisson count data. Again, there are very stringent criteria that give rise to a Poisson distribution. We talked about them at least twice last quarter. Right? It's the memoryless property, a constant rate. So in other words, the number of observed counts in one interval does not affect the number of observed counts in another interval. And the probability of observing two events with as the interval shrinks to zero goes to zero. Those are pretty hard to satisfy restrictions that give rise to a Poisson distribution, at least in practice. So we'll look at one example here. So suppose this is the example actually that I gave to you guys yesterday when I was trying to emphasize to you the importance of thinking about correlation in a data set when you're estimating the variance. So suppose that I had binary responses. And on the ith sampling unit, say for response J and response K, again, think about that as two students in this classroom, suppose that the correlation is of an exchangeable form, so in other words, it's a constant row between any two observations. And then, in fact, my expectation of each of those observations is equal to mu I. Well, we know then that the variance for each binary response is mu I times 1 minus mu I. Individual response is simply Bernoulli's, but now let's think about the mean and variance of taking the sum of those guys, those Bernoulli's, and dividing by mi. And what you guys saw yesterday, I won't repeat it for you on the board. What you saw yesterday, though, in lecture one, was that the expectation of yi was still equal to mu I, but for the variance of yi, you got something that looked like mu times 1 minus mu over m, but then you got this extra trailing term that was out here, right? And the fact is that extra trailing term came from all the pairwise covariances between my y's that were floating around. And of course, that's a function of rho. And so the implications of this is that If I assume I truly have independence floating around, so in other words, that the sum of the yij's is binomial, this would have been my variance. It would have been mu times 1 minus mu over n. But if I've got rho greater than 0, so I've got positive correlation within the ith sampling unit, then that true variance is going to be larger than what is assumed by the binomial model. So if I go into GLM and I tie family equals binomial, my variance assumption is going to be wrong. It's not going to account for the fact that I've got that 1 plus n minus 1 times rho sitting there. Okay? Similarly, if rho is less than 0, I'm going to have a variance that's smaller than the binomial variance. Anybody want to take a guess at what the name of that phenomena is? Under dispersion, right? So you've got over dispersion, true variance is greater than that assumed by the model. Under dispersion, true variance is less than that assumed by the model. So next time we'll show also that if you've got Poisson data, and just a simple case where if I have some covariate that's out there, think about counts here, maybe think about the seizure counts, right? The epileptic seizure counts, call that Y for a second. And then take Z to be males and females, for example. Okay? And let's suppose that males, we'll take them to be Z equals 0. Truly, the number of epileptic seizures observed on them follows a Poisson distribution with some rate, lambda 0. And then for females, they have their number of epileptic seizures follows some rate or some Poisson distribution with rate parameter lambda 1. So it's a different rate parameter. So males are different than females with respect to the propensity for having seizures, as an example. But suppose that you didn't measure or you don't have in your data set gender, right? So you just observe the count. So what you're able to model then is just the marginal distribution of Y. Right? You don't know what Z is. Well, if that's the case, then you can write down, and we will do this next time, the marginal mean of Y looks like a mixture of the two underlying rates. That's what you would expect, right? It's the proportion of females in the population times their rate, and then plus the proportion of males in the population times their rate. So it's an average of those two things. But the variance, if I call that mu, is no longer equal to that mean. The variance is equal to that mean plus something that's sitting out there. And that should be very strong evidence to convince you guys that if you're dealing with count data, 99 out of 100 times it's going to be over dispersed. That term right there is always positive, right? So it basically says even if I truly have Poisson distributed responses in the population, if I can measure everything, as soon as I leave something out of my model that's predictive of the response and I start aggregating over them, I'm going to start inflating my variance relative to that underlying Poisson distribution. That's why you see count data, you better start to assume that it's going to be over dispersed relative to Poisson. So we'll show this guy next time on Monday for you all. We'll move on to fixes from there.